in this edition of Art Loft. A merging of photography and painting is almost spiritual.
That it's kindred spirits, and people that know our work will see our different styles.
A female scribe who's writing herself into the history books.
The Torah that Julie is writing for us will be the second Torah ever written by a woman.
A miniature world of cut and fold drawings.
I mean, I think they're beautiful, but I don't necessarily think that they should be considered beautiful.
And this choir is beautiful in any language. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James. I'm from Ricart Gallery in Wynwood. This is Art Loft. From miniature cities to minute details, this week we offer up some intricate stories. Our first stop is Global Cuba Fest, a month-long celebration of contemporary Cuban music and culture. In Miami, we caught up with a group of singers whose songs of lament and resistance blend harmoniously with topics of faith and social change. They call themselves Grupo Vocal de Sandan, but to the rest of the world, they're known as the Creole Choir of Cuba.
Get ready for the Creole Choir of Cuba.
Miami Light Project is a cultural organization. We've been around here in South Florida for 23 years. We present the best of contemporary dance, music, theater, multimedia artists from around the world here in South Florida. Years ago, we were approached by an organization called Spiegel World to put together a Cuban music program for a big venue that they were putting up on Miami Beach. It was actually a big, beautiful, old world tent. And they were looking for Miami-based cultural organizations to develop programming. I immediately said, okay, I want to do this, and I want to do it together with Everett Fundarte because they're an exemplary organization.
Fundarte is a cultural nonprofit organization based here in Miami with the mission of producing, presenting, and promoting all kind of art disciplines with an emphasis in Hispanic audience and artists. Just an emphasis because we like to get everybody together as one community. We have an event called Global Cuba Fest when we bring artists from Cuba, a Cuban diaspora, that we could present this event with Miami Light Project. We love to collaborate with everybody in town and in the world. We started this festival 6 years ago in collaboration with Miami Light Project. In that time, it was forbidden to bring artists from Cuba. So we decided to create an event, a performance event, where we can showcase 100% Cuban arts in Miami with Cubans that are in diaspora. They were living in Spain, in Canada, in New York, in Miami.
Miami Light Project presented the Creole Choir of Cuba, which was then called Grupo Vocal de Sandan. They're from Camagüey, Cuba. And it was a really extraordinary moment in Miami history because it was one of the first times that a group from Cuba was presented here in Miami, and it was met with just wonderful success, open arms, by both the Cuban community and by the rest of the community in Miami.
Todos somos de Camagüey, Cuba. Y la presencia haitiana ha estado en todas las provincias de Cuba. Formamos el grupo como con la intención de promocionar todas las bellas canciones que habíamos estado escuchando en nuestras casas desde que nacimos y que nos pareció muy justo. Yo siempre digo que es como saldar una deuda con nuestros antepasados, porque sumergido siempre en la discriminación, pues muy pocas personas se han detenido a pensar un poco en su cultura, en sus bellas canciones. En nuestro repertorio hay todos los temas posibles, todo lo que habla de las actividades del ser humano, las actividades en este caso del haitiano, canciones de amor, canciones de cuna, canciones sociales, de todo, cantos de trabajo, de todo tenemos en nuestro repertorio. Aunque cantamos en otro idioma, ese mensaje llega. Las personas han llorado cuando la situación realmente lo amerita, ¿no? Porque el mensaje es triste, o han bailado con nosotros cuando hay que bailar.
Singing in Creole, Spanish, and English, the choir now celebrates the history of their Haitian ancestry with audiences around the world. For more information, visit creolechoir.com or log on to fondarte.us or log on to miamilightproject.com.
But this one I kind of felt I had to do, and it came from standing in line with a 7-Eleven and looking at the security camera and noticing a really large bald spot on the back of my head that I not actually realized was there. A surprise. It seemed like a good time to document that particular aging process.
Remembering the Jewish High Holy Days, our next story takes us to San Francisco, California's Contemporary Jewish Museum, where Julie Seltzer, a female scribe, is breaking ground by writing out an entire Torah, a sacred Jewish text. Being a woman in this traditionally male-dominated field, Seltzer continues to make history, one ancient letter at a time.
Ata tedaber et kol asher atzavecha, ve'aron achicha yedaber el paro, v'shilach et bnei Yisrael me'artzo. You shall repeat all that I command you, and your brother Aaron shall speak to Pharaoh to let the Israelites depart from his land. I generally say or sing or chant a prayer or a line to get in a ready state and a focused state with the right intention.
Julie Seltzer is a soferet, or scribe, performing a tradition that has been passed down for thousands of years. A feather quill, bottle of ink, and 62 sheets of parchment are all she needs to create a sacred Torah.
A scroll of the Torah is probably the oldest continuous document that humanity has. And the Torah scroll, that is the handwritten scroll of the five books of Moses, represents God's wisdom and what human beings need to know in order to be human beings. For someone to take on the sacred, holy responsibility of writing a Torah is an extraordinary commitment.
I don't think of joy and hard work as being separated. It's also an opportunity to be more quiet in a world that often feels very rushed and loud and overwhelming.
The scribe is governed by elaborate rules for how the scribe would copy a Torah, including the number of letters in each book and the number of paragraphs and the number of columns, and they're all checked and double-checked to make sure that the Torah that we read in the synagogue today is, to the best of human capabilities, flawless and exactly like the one God, according to legend, gave Moses on Mount Sinai, that was written in black fire on white fire.
So this is one of my favorite letters, the letter Pei. While it's a Pei with the black ink in the formation of the letter, what you see on the inside in the white space is actually another Hebrew letter. It's the Bet. I read the words and then I say them and then I write them. It helps the scribe to not make errors.
Though she is following centuries-old scribal rules, Julie is actually breaking with tradition in two ways. She is a woman in a field dominated by male scribes. And instead of a scribe's customary solitude, Julie is writing her Torah in public view at the Contemporary Jewish Museum.
According to traditional Jewish law, only a Torah that's written by an adult Jewish male will be kosher for use. So this is why women haven't historically been scribes.
Barred from traditional scribal schools because of her gender, Julie looked online and found a teacher willing to train a woman.
The Torah that Julie is writing for us will be the second Torah ever written by a woman. 20 years ago, it was not common to find very many female rabbis. And things have really changed and progressed. And so I'm hoping in 20 years, it will not be unusual to have a female scribe.
For Julie, being commissioned to write a Torah was a dream come true. But performing a spiritual act in public is proving a bit of a challenge.
I don't know of any other museum who's really, over a year period, had somebody, in a sense, on view doing their work. There are artists who, as part of a performance piece, their work includes people and interaction, but not something that's trying to produce something that then will be sacred and used. So we really have been struggling with how to balance the interest of our visitors with the needs of Julie as she writes the Torah.
When she first started, visitors used to come right up to Julie to peer over her shoulder. Now her space is cordoned off, and a live video projection offers a voyeuristic view of her hand at work. Regularly scheduled breaks allow visitors the chance to ask their most burning questions.
I'm just wondering, I'm sure there are times when there are mistakes made, and I'm just curious about how you fix those mistakes.
Thank you for recognizing that certainly there would be mistakes. The biggest myth is that a scribe can't make any mistakes, and if you make a mistake, you have to start the whole Torah over, which I think is kind of a remarkable myth, simply because people actually believe it, which is amazing.
Because something is holy, it doesn't mean that you necessarily want to stay away from it, because holiness is also about coming close to something. So for me, that's what's amazing, to be able to share that process. I get to be very close to the Torah as I'm writing it, and people, as they watch, can also be part of that process.
Before she became a scribe, Julie was a baker for a Jewish retreat center. She would often shape ritual breads into her favorite scenes from the Torah.
I've made everything from a scene of people getting swallowed up by the earth. It was a giant mound, challah, ripped apart with little people flailing about, to ritual objects. And this year is based on scribal oddities or interesting things connected to a scribe's work. So it's usually words or other things connected to how Torah is written.
As part of her residency at the museum, Julie is combining her dual passions for baking and scribal arts by conducting food for thought workshops for visitors.
So we're going to be making hamantaschen, but that's not the only thing that we're going to be doing. We're going to be talking about the holiday of Purim.
After studying a passage from the Torah, the class gathers in the museum's kitchen to make baked goods related to that portion of the text.
I love doing baking workshops and sessions because it's a way for people to connect with Torah with an easier entryway than the text. And everyone gets to participate and everyone gets to learn through doing.
Taking time to interact with the public has its rewards, but at this point, Julie is beginning to feel the pressure of completing the Torah. She's about a third of the way through and must finish by December. At the rate of one column a day, the work is painstaking and precise.
Kind of like if you're going to run a marathon, you have the training schedule, and if you follow the schedule, you'll be ready to run the marathon. So I have my Torah schedule, and if I write the amount that I need to write every day, then I'll complete it on time, God willing.
Right around the corner from Julie's desk, visitors can lift a cloth to see a few of the sheets completed so far. Eventually, they will be bound together into one scroll and offered to a community in need of a Torah.
One of the great things about learning about the Torah is that they're always done anonymously. So there's only 304,805 letters, it does not allow you to sign your name to the Torah. We'll be sending this Torah out in the world to be used, and eventually no one will even know that Julie wrote this Torah, because it will just be one of the Torahs being used by a congregation somewhere who will really read it and use it as a sacred object, and who wrote it is not important, but it will have a new life as a living document.
To learn more, visit the website of the Contemporary Jewish Museum at thecjm.org.
A concern on her face, and I think that in Key West we have a bit of concern about the nature here and the ecology here. So that's me, I'm like, these are the things I read into it.
Artist Gary Khachaturian takes a real hands-on approach with his work. His books are full of drawings of objects from everyday life. From sofas to ATM machines, his miniatures create a world unto themselves. The objects may be common, but Khachaturian believes they can still be art.
Choosing the kinds of objects I choose is really largely because I'm interested in them. I mean, I think they're beautiful, but I don't necessarily think that they should be considered beautiful. It's just what sticks in your brain, and you know, you assume that what's staying in your brain is something that tells something about you, probably, and that's kind of the point of making art. When I look at other artists' work, you know, half of it is what I can find out about the way they think. This is one of the last projects I finished, which is a book of cut and fold objects, anything from a self-portrait, to spotted pots, to barriers, you know, vacant lot, snowball stand, things you drive by every day and that are fairly central and elemental to, you know, society that we live in. This piece is a brand new set of the like cut and fold series, and it's a apartment dumpster, which I've done a few flat ones of before, but this is a three-dimensional one, and a sofa with removable cushions, because there's always, when you go by apartment complexes, you always see like a sofa next to the dumpster. I did this self-portrait a few years ago. It's actually the only, I guess, mammal I've done a drawing of in probably 6 years. But this one I kind of felt I had to do, and it came from standing in line with a 7-Eleven and looking at the security camera and noticing a really large bald spot on the back of my head that I not actually realized was there. A surprise. It seemed like a good time to document that particular aging process. I don't look at any of these things being mass produced at this point. So this book sold for $4. I sell at different, mostly like artist books outlets, places like Quimby's in Chicago, Printed Matter in New York, and locally. I do posters, and this is actually another scale version of the vacant lot. Behind it, and both these panels actually, were ceiling panels that I'd had up before. So they're a drawing of a drop ceiling, acoustic tile. And then the last of this kind of sequence is an installation that I did on a building on North and Charles. That uses a bush in early spring and a decorative block wall. From the point of view of like making the drawings, you have to make it in an uncompromising manner, you know, but at the same time make it so that people might find it interesting to look at. It's a tough thing, you know, you're not trying to bend to please them, you're trying to make something that will please them on your terms.
To see more of his work, visit his website at garykhachaturian.com.
This Metamorphosis is all about telling the Greek myths of Ovid in a highly theatrical setting. And so what we're doing for our first show of our Theater Up Close series is we're actually building a 17-foot pool in the Carnival Studio Theater. And the play actually takes place on a stage around the pool and inside the pool.
Our final story tonight takes us to the studios of Key West, a hub for artistic activity in the lower Florida Keys, where we met two artists, one working in photography and the other with paint. Now, despite their different mediums, they share much in common. Both are grant recipients from the Southern Florida Cultural Consortium, both migrated to Key West from chilly Brooklyn, New York, and both are thrilled to be collaborating. You could even call them kindred spirits.
I think, yes, we're definitely the kindred spirits. I think for me, it was a joining of two voices that really just wanted to celebrate this island, the beauty of this island, the beauty of the people of this island.
I'm Nellie Appleby.
Hi, I'm Marlene Koenig.
I'm more of the photographer.
And I'm more of the painter.
What's really nice about this island is the community, and I think people will say it over and over again, you know, Key West, what is it about you that draws you to it?
And I came to town actually to do a residency here at the studios of Key West in 2009, and it was really wonderful because it was sort of a direct artery into meeting the artists of the island. This one is called Fierce Spirit of Cayo Hueso. We're working together in terms of collaborative pieces like this one here. Was really organic and fun process of having ideas and merging our two medias, for example, photography and painting.
This is a drawing and a watercolor painting that I've done, and then we've attached it to the cyanotype.
Cyanotypes are photographs made without a lens, without a camera, and it's basically using a light-sensitive material that I make, I put on paper, and then I use sunshine to burn in the imagery and water to wash the whole thing, which sounds pretty vague, but it's basically a sun print.
And then there's just a shellacking that goes on and adheres them together and brings the spirits together.
Ooh, art. Well, I would like to think of it as more of a merging, and that it's kindred spirits. And people that know our work will see our different styles and our different mediums. But I really think that this is a collaborative piece. And I think it also represents Key West to me. We have a bike ride here, the zombie bike ride. And she has some, her face paint reminds me a little bit of this ride, and the net reminds me of Key West and the sea. But I think that she also has a little bit of a concern on her face. And I think that in Key West, we have a bit of concern about the nature here and the ecology here. So that's me. That's me. I'm like, these are the things I read into it.
And what I also really like about it is because Nellie and I work in such different mediums, and that's also what drew me to Nellie, is that I saw a kindred spirit, but that worked so differently than I did, but was still kind of trying to talk about the same things. And I think this piece, which is so nice about it, is it talks about the same things in such different ways. And for me, I'm talking about spirit, that thing that lives in us. And it might be a fierce spirit, a dark spirit, a wild spirit. And it's figurative, and that's how I work. And when I look at Nellie's contribution, which is this beautiful cyanotype that she did in the back, it really resonates spirit with me. It's got that unearthliness. That so why I think this is a successful piece is it talks about spirit in two very different ways, and I think people can hear that. Our art comes from a really joyful place, and I hope that people get that.
Beyond their collaborative work, Nellie and Marlene showcase independently, and Nellie's work is currently part of an exhibition at the Deering Estate called Forget Me Not. If you'd like to learn more about either one of these artists, you can visit each of them online at nellieappleby.com or marlenekoenig.com. And to learn more about the studios at Key West, visit tskw.org. And that wraps it up for this edition of Art Loft. For more arts and culture, visit wpbt2.org/artloft, where you'll find featured videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. You can also watch older episodes of Art Loft, and you can look for us on Facebook and Twitter at Art Loft SFL. Until next week, I'm your host, Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Thanks for watching.
Yeah, he's taking one.
I see you back there.
It's like, because I don't,
like, you can't have too much energy because it's kind of serious, but I guess I can. No, it's after this. Slow down, Johnny. You're so anxious to turn. Slow, reel it in. It's good. Right, it's like, sprinkler. I turned and it wasn't up, so I just turned back.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.